Namaste. Hi. So here we are, the pandemic present. Rules are relaxing. We're trying to get back to a life of semi-normalcy, or at least what used to be normal. But everything has changed. What hasn't changed though is that the virus is still present out there. And with it still present out there, there are a lot of things that we need to do and we need to keep in mind. While protocol and SOP is being announced everywhere, there are also a lot of areas where we do not have personal clarity as to how things work, as to how things operate. We've seen neighbors go off to hospital. We've seen neighbors come back. We've heard of people not being there anymore. But clarity is what lends fact to what could be fiction. And that's what actually gives us confidence, which is why we reached out to Apollo Hospitals and we brought you a series of facts and a series of things that we really need to know to be more confident in COVID times. And for our very first installment, we have with us Dr. Ram Subramanian, Senior Consultant, Infectious Diseases here at Apollo Hospital. Namaste, Doctor. Today, I want us to understand that it is okay for us to come to a hospital. We do not have to be scared if we need to.
Absolutely not. Hospitals are safe places. At least reputed hospitals have in place a system where infection control is a very, very important part of the daily functioning, which means they have systems and protocols in place to keep the health workers safe and these patients safe.
Because there are people with other health conditions who are now hesitant to come into hospitals. So latent conditions like diabetes or hypertension itself, or even to the extent of ignoring maybe a mild angina, fear.
To tell you the truth, I feel safer inside the hospital than outside.
You do, because you know the reality. Help us know the reality.
A hospital is a controlled situation where if there is a patient whom I suspect COVID is a possibility, he's isolated. When we enter the room to see him, we wear protective personal equipment. So I'm safe. What I can't predict is if I'm outside in a shop, I'm standing in a queue to pay the bill, and the person in front of me turns, you know, around and sneezes or coughs
and
in front of me.
There you go.
I can't do it.
So if there is any other health issue, walk in into your hospital and you are going to be fine.
The only thing is, small addendum is, take an appointment and come.
Reason being?
Because in this time of pandemic, every person could be harboring COVID, which means they may be symptomatic, they may be asymptomatic. So you could be at risk to someone else if you are young, asymptomatic, and could be harboring COVID, which could be spread to others.
Okay.
So key points to keep in mind. One, even in the hospital, try to be physically distanced. Two, ensure that you always wear a mask.
What are the symptoms as on date? Because they keep changing.
You're right. There are newer and newer symptoms which people are identifying with COVID. If you remember that the basic symptoms you need to look for is fever. Not all of them may have fever. Feeling feverish, having chills, feeling very tired and lethargic, having severe body pains and aches. You may have diarrhea sometimes. People have a cough. Sometimes it's not a cough, it's just a irritation in the throat or a sore throat. Most of these may occur independently of each other. You could have a couple of these symptoms alone.
Okay.
It is also possible that you may have one or two symptoms which last for a day or two and then settle down. But during times of COVID, as we are facing now, whenever anybody has a couple of these symptoms, you have to consider the possibility of COVID.
But can we add loss of smell
to
this?
Yes, I think that's a very, very important symptom which they have recently associated with COVID. But they did a study recently and found in other respiratory infections also this can happen. So this is not pathognomonic or specific for COVID. But we find a number of patients who have COVID also present with loss of taste and with or without loss of smell.
Oh, so okay, the loss of taste with the loss of smell, I would have ended up attributing it to the loss of smell, but just loss of taste alone.
Yes, yes. Or in other words, there could be a relative impairment in one with a complete loss of the other.
Okay.
So that is also, and again, in times like this, that strongly denotes COVID.
Over what time period? For how many days should these persist?
2 to 3 days is enough hint to say that it could be COVID.
Okay. And combined with any other one more symptom at a minimum for 2 days, we reach out to our primary physician, we go meet him, or do we call him?
Please remember that when somebody has symptoms of COVID, he can be infectious to others.
Correct.
So I don't want a patient to be sitting in the middle of a waiting room without a mask, putting others at risk.
Okay.
So you need to call your doctor to find out a suitable time to come so that you don't need to wait, see him, and then discuss with him.
What happens next?
There is no specific preventive medicine for COVID, and there is no specific treatment modality for COVID. There are several agents which have been tried.
Mm-hmm.
What is still works is only paracetamol and oxygen.
How does paracetamol help? Body pain?
For the fever and body pain.
Okay.
All the other medicines, whether it is HCQS, whether it is remdesivir, whether it is lopinavir, ritonavir, whether it is newer ivermectin, any of these drugs are still to be used only in the context of a trial.
Mm-hmm.
They are not recommended as agents which will definitely help.
Zinc, vitamin C?
All of them. They are non-specific. They may boost your immune system, but none of them have been recommended by any organization or association as a specific treatment which will help in the recovery of COVID patients. Okay. We are still in the realm of trials only.
These are my symptoms. I've called my doctor. I need to get a test done immediately. My doctor would recommend. How do I get the test?
See, it depends. As I told you, since there is no specific prevention, the main aim is to ensure that in case you have COVID, you don't spread it to others. I personally do not mandate a test for everybody with a symptom of a couple of days who may have COVID or whom I may suspect to have COVID. There are certain things which you may have to consider if a COVID test is warranted.
Mm-hmm.
One, the age. The elderly people who are over the age of 60 have a higher risk of developing complications and running into problems and death.
Mm-hmm.
So they definitely need a COVID test.
Mm-hmm.
A person who has underlying diabetes, underlying heart disease, lung disease, the person who may be on immunosuppressive medications. So people, what we call as vulnerable people or people who have a possibility of running into complications, warrant a test. Similarly, a healthcare worker warrants a test. A young person who's 25 without any issues, having a mild fever and cough or a sore throat and a body pain, and who can isolate or quarantine himself, I don't insist on a test, provided I can ensure that he stays isolated and doesn't spread it to anybody.
Okay.
But if it happens to be somebody of a lower middle class, a person who doesn't have the infrastructure, he stays in a single bedroom with a family of four, I insist on a test because we need to isolate these people. But if it is an affluent person, a middle or an upper middle class person who has the wherewithal to stay at home in a single room, understand the implications and the complications of this illness, I permit them not to do the test but stay at home.
What are the implications?
One, as I told you, if they belong to any of the vulnerable group, they can deteriorate rapidly.
Okay.
In other words, they may be fine this morning, but by tomorrow morning, they may be gasping.
Okay.
You need to monitor them. So if it's an affluent person who can afford a pulse oximeter to check their oxygen levels periodically and who can understand how to interpret them and can be in touch with the doctor if things go wrong, yes, I let them isolate themselves. If, as I told you, the person is on medicines which may impair his immune response, then you need to be extra careful with that person. And similarly, as I told you, if it is a person who cannot stay in a single room away from his family, physically distanced from the family, or he doesn't understand the seriousness of or the importance of staying within the house or isolated, and he can walk out, or take it lightly, you need to do the test and isolate him in an institution.
And that's where the complication sets in, with him walking out.
Yes. Yes.
You have mandated a test and they've tested COVID positive. They're not able to isolate. They come into hospital. What happens?
It can be in two or three categories. A person who's young, without any comorbidities, no issues which may cause complications, mild illness, they can be home quarantined or they can be quarantined in what we call a COVID care center.
Is that like a dormitory or are they?
Something like
that. They're not individual rooms normally.
I don't think under government setup you have individual rooms. So they are all positive patients, so they can be cohorted together, but they need to be kept away from the general population.
Because there's nothing more they can spread to each other any which way. It's one strain.
Yes.
Okay.
As of now.
Touch wood.
So these people need to be kept away from the population and you need to put them in a safe place where they can be fed and where an eye can be kept on them to ensure that they are not going down. Category C are sick patients who require hospital care and probably ICU care.
ICU care and what happens with severe case patients is something that we're going to see going ahead. But today I want us to understand, how long can a person expect to stay in the hospital in case it's hospital mandated isolation?
It depends. Earlier we used to have mandatory testing after 14 days, two tests, nasal swab, PCR test to be done and be negative before he can be released. But we don't do test-based discharge, we now do time-based discharge. So time is a criteria, which means if the person remains asymptomatic for 3 days, which means without fever and the cough has come down, and it is at least 10 days after the start of the illness, he can be discharged.
Oh.
So okay. If I start illness, say on the 20th,
okay,
I get admitted to the hospital on the 25th,
yeah,
and after 27th, I am fine. 28, 29, 30th, which 30. Is 10 days after the onset and 3 days after I become asymptomatic, I can be sent home.
Okay.
But you need to be under home quarantine for one more week.
Okay. And the rest of the people at home?
If you have a person who is COVID positive in a household,
mm-hmm.
the risk to the household members is very, very high.
Yes.
In fact, as with regard to contacts, the highest risk is for household members. They need to be quarantined for at least 2 weeks.
Them too, at home.
Do a test for them in 7 to 10 days time, which is the same for healthcare workers also. So do a test in 7 to 10 days time. But if you are able to quarantine them for 14 days, that is ideal.
And the immediate surrounding neighbors interaction?
Unless you have had contact with somebody. Any contact, we tend to categorize them as low risk, medium risk or high risk. So if I am within 3 feet of you.
What are we? By default, we just don't, because then I have to touch my makeup again.
Yes.
So you wear makeup.
Shown that
no.
A woman touches her face as an average of about 23 times.
More than a man?
No, 23 no. times.
Okay.
I think it's per hour.
They also found out that medical students touch their face on an average, yeah, more often than anybody else.
I finished my medicine long back, so.